You're watching Tag TV. You're watching Tag TV.
Hello viewers, I'm your host Shreya Savijay with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show. While India shares a robust bilateral relationship with almost all its neighbours, its ties with island nation Sri Lanka have been unique. The bond between the two has experienced both blows and breakthroughs over the last few years. However, with the transition of power in Colombo, the past few months have been significant. At the helm of Sri Lankan affairs, the Rajapaksa brothers have set country's external policy straight, and it talks of having a comprehensive revival and facelift of relations with New Delhi. A report. Indo-Sri Lanka bilateral ties received a major boost as Prime Minister Mahinda Rajapaksa, who is once again at the helm of affairs with his brother Gotabaya Rajapaksa, made a 5-day visit to India. The visit came in the line of sustained efforts being made by both sides to restore the bond they shared a few years back. An increased Chinese interference in the island nation had drifted them apart. And now, when the depth diplomacy of Beijing has been exposed, the oscillating Indo-Sri Lanka relationship is reclaiming its position and is aiming to comprehensively boost the partnership. Colombo wants India to invest more in Sri Lanka and has allowed several Indian-assisted projects to take off in its country. It also seeks Indian support in reviving its sagging economy. Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi, on the other side, ensured that terrorism, to which both India and Sri Lanka have lost hundreds of lives in past few years, remained the focus of the conversation, and even granted it a sum of $50 million to work in that direction.
आतंकवाद हमारे क्षेत्र में एक बहुत बड़ा खतरा है। हम दोनों देशों ने इस समस्या को डटकर मुकाबला किया है।
I also appreciate the Prime Minister Modi's offer of $400 million as a credit line to enhance the economy of Sri Lanka and another $50 million credit line for our efforts in combating terrorism.
Sri Lanka's future course of diplomacy became quite clear when Prime Minister Rajapaksa described the bond between the two as a relation while calling others as friends. Making an indirect statement at Beijing, which could be deemed a diplomatic victory of New Delhi, Rajapaksa said that his government has a firm policy on not allowing any natural resources to be given to foreign control. While there have been a lot of issues where Sri Lanka has committed towards Indian interest, a number of significant fault lines still linger between the two. Colombo, which doesn't want to see the straining of its relationship with Islamabad, wants to see the revival of SAARC. India opposes it for the presence of Pakistan, which has carried out numerous terror attacks against it. India too has its demands from Sri Lanka, in which it seeks more rights for Indian origin Tamils.
मुझे विश्वास है कि श्रीलंका सरकार यूनाइटेड श्रीलंका के भीतर समानता, न्याय, शांति और सम्मान के लिए तमिल लोगों की अपेक्षाओं को साकार करेगी।
While Rajapaksa refrained from talking about SAARC during the visit, he also didn't commit to one particular position on the 13th Amendment of Sri Lankan Constitution. In fact, he said that no solution to the problem will happen without it being acceptable to the majority community, which is Sinhalese in the country. Now it remains to be seen how New Delhi convinces Colombo into changing its stance, or the Colombo administration will ever budge from its position. Barring these two issues, the two sides have clearly resolved to take the camaraderie to newer heights. With Maldives as another partner in the region, the trio is poised to become a grouping that will be mutually beneficial for all in the coming times. Moving on, while Pakistan has long used terrorism as an instrument of its state policy to harm other nations, it has employed equally cruel tactics to subjugate people of non-Punjabi ethnicity inside its own territory. Whether it is Baloch, Pashtun or Sindhi, they all have been meted out highest degree of atrocities. And now, when the individual ethnic movements against the establishment are gaining traction, Islamabad has grown nervous. It is using all resources at its disposal to quash the movements. Recently, a Muhajir leader exposed the civil army nexus and asked his community to refrain from believing the narratives being peddled by them. A report.
Muhajirs, the people who travel across the border during the partition of India, have never been treated with dignity in Pakistan. For past 7 decades, they have been accorded a second-class citizen treatment with the Islamabad establishment, regularly floating new laws to further suppress them. Vandalized memorials and other places of prayers have become a recurring phenomenon in Pakistan. People accuse state hand behind any form of destruction. And any form of demand seeking justice or expressing dissent has been crushed with brute high-handedness. The voices representing the marginalized have been put behind bars. Pakistan has even peddled lies, demonizing the Muhajir leaders. Condemning Pakistan's narrative, founder leader of Mutahida Qaumi Movement or NQM, Altaf Hussain has said, "No power in the world can end the word Muhajir, and those saying that we have sold the Muhajir name should not fall into the propaganda."
Lafz Muhajir qayamat tak khatam nahi hoga. Khuda ke waste saazishon mein mat aao. Ye chand takon ki jo aaj Muhajiron ke hamdard ban rahe hain, 4 saal se 5 saal se to mera 5 saal se to meri koi mudakhalat denge. क्या किया इन्होंने? मुहाजिरों के घर तोड़े, झुकियां तोड़ी, कारोबार तबाह किया, उनको बेघर किया, वो नालों पे रह रहे हैं, वो बेघर है, खाने को नहीं है।
This comes a month after Shafi Burfat, the chairman of GS in the Mutahida Mahas, announced that Muhajir leader Altaf Hussain will be the head of the Sindhu Desh government, an idea of a separate homeland for Sindhis proposed by Sindhi nationalist parties. While calling Muhajirs and Sindhis to unite for freedom from Pakistan rule, Hussain, who lives in self-exile in London, said that although the identity of the Muhajir is different, but now their homeland is Sindh.
Allah ke waste fauj ke agenton ki baat mein na aao. Maine apna ghar baar sab kuch chaliye lutaya tha ke main is lafz ko beizzat karaunga. Aaj ke baad se aap dekhiye Sindhi lafz. सिंधी बोलने वाले खुदा की कसम महाजन लफ्ज को मोहब्बत से बोलेंगे, लेकिन वतन हमारा सिंधी है तो वतन के हिसाब से हम सिंधी हुए, हम सिंधी हुए, हम सिंधी हुए।
In a show of unity, Sindhi nationalist parties and Muhajir political leaders last month held joint rallies and raised pro-freedom slogans in Sindh, saying they do not want to live in a terrorist, theocratic and a fascist state of Pakistan. In a joint chorus, Sindhis and Muhajirs have said that they will not live under the rule of Pakistanis and will go to any extent to achieve their freedom, which Pakistan has crushed for more than 7 decades.
Pakistan's duplicity has been exposed globally as the same administration which observes Solidarity Day for Kashmiris has been unleashing barbarity on the indigenous Kashmiris. It has plundered almost all resources of the region and has not accorded even the fundamental rights to the natives. Recently, Kashmiri activists called out the Pakistan's falsehoods, stating Islamabad's sympathy absolute fraud, trying to mislead international community. Pakistan observes February 5 as Kashmir Solidarity Day, which it says is to renew its pledge of continuing support to the Kashmiris fighting for their right to so-called self-determination. However, it ironically continues to occupy POK and Gilgit-Baltistan, the part of the princely state of Jammu and Kashmir. A political activist from Pakistan-occupied Kashmir strongly condemned the Kashmir Solidarity Day by calling it a fraud.
پانچ فروری یوم یکجہتی کشمیر ایک فراڈ ہے اس کا کشمیر کے ساتھ کوئی تعلق نہیں ہے کوئی ایسا واقعہ نہیں ہے کہ جس کو اس دن منایا جائے یہ جماعت اسلامی اور بیسیکلی جو ہے ضیاء الحق انہوں نے یہ دن طے کیا تاکہ کشمیری جو ایک شاونسٹک اپروچ ہے جموں کشمیر کی پالیٹکس میں اس کو اسٹرینتھن کیا جائے اور جو یہ وہاں پہ ٹیررزم کا جو پلان تھا پاکستانی اسٹیٹ کا آفٹر دا افغان وار اس کو وہاں پہ انکریج بھی کیا جائے اور اس کو ایک پبلک سپورٹ اس کے لیے جنریٹ کی جائے کشمیر کے یوفوریا میں.
ناصر عزیز خان, a prominent Kashmiri activist and spokesperson of United Kashmir People's National Party, said if Pakistan really has sympathies for Kashmiris, then it should give autonomous rights to people in Pakistan-occupied Kashmir, a region under its illegal occupation.
بابا جان, افتخار حسین ایگزامپلز ہیں, ان کو آپ نے 80-90 سال کی سزائیں سنائی ہوئی ہیں. وہ پیسفل اسٹرگل پہ بلیو کرتے ہیں, وہ کوئی نیشنلسٹ بھی نہیں تھے, ٹھیک. اس کے باوجود آپ کو انہوں نے 90-90 سال کی جیلیں دی ہوئی ہیں اور آپ کشمیریوں کے ساتھ سولیڈیریٹی دکھا رہے ہیں. آپ کب تک اپنی قوم کو بھی بیوقوف بنائیں گے کشمیر کے نام پہ؟ آپ نے کہ جو اپنے اسٹیٹ کے لوگ ہیں, چاہے وہ پشتونز ہیں, چاہے وہ بلوچ ہیں, چاہے وہ سندھی ہیں, کیا آپ نے ان کا جو رائٹ ٹو سیلف ڈیٹرمنیشن ہے جس کے لیے وہ اسٹرگل کر رہے ہیں, اپنے رائٹس کے لیے, اپنی آزادیوں کے لیے وہ اسٹرگل کر رہے ہیں, کیا آپ ان کو یہ رائٹ دینے کے لیے تیار ہیں؟ نہیں, آپ ان کا یہ رائٹ ماننے کے لیے تیار نہیں ہیں. ان پہ آپ گن شپ ہیلی کاپٹر سے, فائٹر جیٹ سے اور جو بڑی ہیوی مشین گنز ہیں ان سے بمبارمنٹ کرتے ہیں اور ان کے گھروں کو تباہ کرتے ہیں, ان کے بچوں کو, عورتوں کو مارتے ہیں, اٹھاتے ہیں, اور آپ کشمیریوں کے ساتھ کیا سولیڈیریٹی کریں گے؟
پیپل ان پاکستان آکوپائڈ کشمیر ہیو لانگ ریزڈ کنسرنز اوور پاکستانز ایل ٹریٹمنٹ اینڈ دے آر ناٹ الاؤڈ ٹو ڈیمانڈ ایون دیئر بیسک رائٹس. They blame the limited autonomy granted to the local government is a conspiracy to show the world that the illegally occupied region is a self-governing state. Moving on to capital city of Afghanistan, where a Japanese robot waitress has become talk of the town. It is not just serving food in a restaurant, but is drawing out common Afghans' fascination for technology. A large number of diners are visiting the restaurant to enjoy the meal served by the robot. Have a look.
Timia, a robotic waitress, is rolling around and serving people their meals at a restaurant in downtown Kabul. Not all the people coming to the restaurant are interested in food, but are fascinated by the way in which a robot is serving meals. Timia has become a local celebrity.
بسیار خوب است که ما خوشحال شدیم که دیدیم که یک ربات با ما سرویس میکنه و با فامیلیام بسیار خوب است دیگه همین تکنولوژی درو به پیشرفت است.
Decades of war in Afghanistan have deprived people of quality education. A large section of the population hasn't had much access to the technological advances the world has witnessed over past few years. Locals say such initiatives are good for the country as they will inspire future generation. The robot attracts Kabul residents to come to the restaurant in a country where many people suffer from daily conflicts and war. Although made in Japan and serving American-style fast food like cola and hamburgers, the Time restaurant team designed the robot with the locals in mind.
هدف کلی و اساسی ما این بوده که یک انگیزه به نسل جوان باشه که با دیدن از این ربات نسل جوان ما ببینن و بتونن در آینده همچون تکنولوژی را انونت کنن و در فناوری یک نوآوری داشته باشن.
Timia brings the food from the restaurant kitchen to the customers, and a particular electronic track is set to Timia to enable her to move to each table freely. The robot speaks Dari and Pashto, as well as English, and his head is designed to look as if he were wearing a hijab, the scarf worn by most Muslim women in Afghanistan.
Moving on to Sri Lanka, where a Buddhist pageant was organized among pomp and splendor in capital Colombo. Hundreds of locals and foreigners were drawn to the pageant that has been held annually for past several years. People say that pageant is a quintessential display of Sri Lankan history and culture.
Tens of thousands of people lined the streets of Sri Lanka's capital Colombo to watch the annual Buddhist pageant. The pageant is marked by hundreds of drummers, traditional dancers and torchbearers escorting dozens of beautifully decorated elephants in a colorful parade. They are accompanied by dozens of colorfully lit up elephants paraded a 3.5 kilometer route. The roads were packed with locals and foreigners. The elephants swayed to the beat of the drums as Buddhist priests, old men and women, and children stayed transfixed for nearly 3 hours it took the parade to pass.
And I'm here for two reasons. The first reason is, yeah, we are here for taking holidays, for relaxing. But the second reason is more important from my point of view, because we are interested in the culture. It's so different, the weather is different. We enjoy the kindness of the people here. It's very different, and we can learn as Germans from.
The pageant, which starts from the Gangaramaya Buddhist temple, one of the prominent religious places in the capital, has been held annually for decades.
The elephants are baited in early afternoon and then dressed in colorful garments. The highlight is a casket carried by a tusker, which Buddhists believe contains a relics of Buddha. Elephants are an important part of several major festivals and shows in South Asia, and a pageant involving the giant animal has become the latest trend in the region, with Nepal and India too hosting such events.
Moving on, Indian fashion industry is taking massive strides with the potential to make a mark on the global stage. It has thousands of years of traditions behind it. Ace designers including Akhil Gupta, Swapnil Shinde, Kunal Rawal displayed their collection in the recently held Lakme Fashion Week 2020 in showbiz capital of the country, Mumbai. South Asia Focus takes a look at this glamorous fashion show.
The country's most popular names in the fashion industry brought active the absolute splendor during the 6-day long India's Lakme Fashion Week 2020 as they displayed their amazing collections. 30 designers reinvented their popular iconic looks with their debut collections and presented them in a contemporary style. Bollywood divas raised the glamour quotient at the fashion show as they walked the ramp for different designers, showcasing the taste of fashion. Dressed in a t-shirt outfit, oversized jacket paired with boots, Bollywood actress and former adult film star Sunny Leone walked the ramp.
This is what I love. It's Disney meeting a woman that wants to do whatever she wants.
Yes.
And a little bit of Jack Daniels doesn't go over, you know, it doesn't hurt anybody. But it's all about the women who, you know, we see these beautiful images of different women, but who are they really, or what do they stand for, and what do they represent? And I think that's what I loved about your collection, is that it comes down to a woman being exactly who she wants to be.
Sharp contrast of strong and soft was showcased with models wearing oversized jackets, long and short dresses in shades of white, black, blue paired with boots. While Bollywood actress Rakulpreet Singh wearing capris paired with white full sleeves shirt with ruffles walked for Ajio, and actress Neha Dhupia presented designs of budding designers during the event.
Young country that is bold, it looks back at things which we should have dumped a long time back. This is a new generation that's taking on things, and fashion and clothing are nothing but a reflection of that new attitude. That's exactly what Ajio stands for.
Another designer whose designs created waves was Kunal Rawal, whose collection broke and focused on bringing out the new from within. While on the other side, Bollywood actor Vicky Kaushal and actress Janhvi Kapoor turned on the heat at the ramp. Vicky wore an ensemble by Kunal Rawal. He looked dapper for a first-timer model in a Mandarin collar, long shirt and pants paired with a jacket.
This is my first time ever that I've walked a ramp. Forget Lakme Fashion Week, but yeah, I'm very happy to be here and to represent Reliance Trends, because like he said, it's the biggest destination for fashion in the country.
This year's flavor of Lakme Fashion Week featured a whooping around 30 celebrity showstoppers who donned a variety of dresses ranging from embellished gowns to fusion ethnic wear.
Fashion industry is growing at a rapid pace with the international developments such as the Indian Fashion Week gaining popularity. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.